Hi, I'm Colonel Rick Searfoss. I'm a former astronaut, and I was the commander of mission STS-90 on Columbia. Also flew two flights as a pilot astronaut in the right seat of the shuttle, first one on Columbia, STS-58. Second mission was the third docking of the space shuttle with the Mir space station on Atlantis, STS-76. Well, there are a number of little veteran tricks from just living in space, and some of them you pick up from your crew, as a rookie, from your crewmates telling you. But one that no one ever told me anything about, and I finally broke the code about 5 days into my first mission, as I noticed my neck was constantly feeling tense and sore. And I thought, oh, it's the fluid shifter. It's some scientific reason. And I finally realized that, no, it's you, Rick. You're doing all your work with your hands kind of down here, which is fine, 1G position, because gravity kind of holds them there and it's a natural position to do your work. But in space, the natural position for your arms is floating up here. And I found when I did all my work up here, which is sort of unnatural because you're not used to doing that, that everything got a lot more comfortable, the neck relaxed, and that was the little tip that I carried forward for the rest of my time. Well, an average day, and of course, we'll talk shuttle missions, which my comparison of a shuttle mission, because I ran track in school, is like a 400-meter race. It's a sprint, but it's a long sprint, and you are just humping every day, 16-hour work days. Now, as opposed to space station operations, where people are up for 6 months at a time, it's a marathon or an ultra-marathon, and you have to pace yourself and everything. So my experience is all shuttle missions, and with that intensity in mind, it starts out with a couple hours they creatively call the post-sleep period. So as a pilot and commander, they basically wake the orbiter systems up and you reposition antennas, you do the cryogenic tank conditioning, and you get all the faxes. We had a fax machine on the shuttle that they would send up all of the changes to the flight plan. You have to get those posted in a very high-tech way using scotch tape into the paper checklists we used to fly. In fact, my kids are very social media, and I got their iPhone like every other kid these days. And I laugh at them and said, you know, I went to space with paper checklists. You don't need all that stuff, you know, but I'm kind of a dinosaur that way. But you get through those activities, then you get into the meat of whatever your payload operations are. And for two of my three flights being lab operations, it's the science. It's all about the science. And for me, as not a science guy per se, but an operational fly of the spaceship, everything was about supporting getting good data with the scientists. So you do whatever it takes to execute whatever the flight plan was to get that done, and a variety of different things going on. There would be the odd NASA would want to do a PR appearance or the Earth observations photographs, all secondary to the mission, but it all fills in to make a very busy day. And towards the end of the day, as it winds down, you've got the creatively named pre-sleep period, where you sort of put the orbiter to bed, you eat your dinner, you typically have a little bit of time as a crew to just hang out together, to talk about how the day's gone, to chill out just a little bit, even play with our food a little bit, and you always see the videos of that. Not much time to do that, but it's all good. It helps kind of relax and wind down so you can be ready to hit the rack and hit it hard to the next day. I'll key on one because it speaks to, it's very global sort of in nature. On my last flight, after dinner one evening, we were chilling, looking out the window. I'm floating next to Dave Williams, my Canadian crewmate, so that's international right there. We're looking down at eastern China, and we can see over to Beijing, up the Korean Peninsula, all the way down to Taiwan. And I said, Dave, do you realize we're looking at a billion people right now? And he goes, yeah, it's amazing. And he said, I feel so connected to them, even though we're so separated right now. And just, we had this discussion, sort of a philosophical discussion about, you know, the connectivity of everyone on the planet. We're all in this together at the end of the day, hurtling through the cosmos. And we felt really very connected to the other 7 billion people down on the planet. And I will never, ever forget sort of the feelings I had of humanity and being a human being with a great privilege to see the planet that way. Ah, the legacy of space shuttle. Again, to circle back to the people side, it was magical to go down to the Cape before a launch or a landing, or to just go down there anytime. And the people, by day, they would work on rocket ships. By night, they might be a redneck fisherman or whatever they were into, you know, just wonderful salt of the earth people. That's a fantastic kind of untold legacy. but it speaks to what we are so good at as Americans, you know, coming together and doing things, operational things, making big things happen when we make up our mind to do it. I think as a government sort of program that's run, it's a great model for other aspects of government on how to do things of benefit and worth to the overall population. We, you know, have challenges in the government really serving the people in our nation as well as we should. And NASA, I think, has always provided a great model of a dedication and focus on the future and bringing benefits back to planet Earth. Because at the end of the day, it's not so much about space or, you know, rocket guys like me riding the rockets. It's about what we can bring back to planet Earth and what we can do to benefit humanity in general and the U.S. taxpayer specifically. What is next is very diverse, and spread. There's a lot going on. In fact, there's a bit of a renaissance that's been happening in the aerospace industry in terms of many, many smaller players that have been enabled by just-in-time inventory supply and the technology, the infotech and everything, so they can do new and creative things, and they don't have to be a huge, massive, multi-billion dollar conglomerate to make it happen. And that creativity is manifesting itself with, you know, unmanned aerial systems all the way from, you know, tiny little bug-sized ones to massive ones. What's happening in the commercial private space sector, which in turn is partnering with NASA. You know, SpaceX is a prime example, but there are many others who are work with NASA in ways that are new and creative and organizationally had not been done before. So there's a lot of great things happening. What we're lacking at the moment compared to days of big programs like Apollo or Space Shuttle is a focus. You know, we're going to go to the moon or we're going to go to Mars by such and such a date. And, you know, I'm thinking that will come along. I certainly hope so. I want to be alive when we go to Mars and put human footprints on the surface of Mars. And we don't have a definitive program saying we're going to do this by such and such a date. But technologies are coming together and things are happening that are still very exciting if you're in the industry and involved with it. Well, the mission, at the end of the day, for the California Science Center is to inspire primarily young people, and then they pick up the ball and, you know, who knows what they'll become, future astronauts, doctors, scientists, engineers, and they play a pivotal role. They've got an incredible vision here at the Science Center with the value of aerospace. Of course, there's a great tie-in to Southern California. I mean, it's movie industry notwithstanding, historically, the largest industry in this area is aerospace, you know. There's so much that's happened in aerospace in this area. And to have a place to showcase that and show young people the technology of how this stuff works, I think is particularly important these days because they're, you know, everywhere you look, you've got amazing special effects or your own, you know, video on your phone and everything. But the reality of taking something that's this massive and big and sending it to space and bringing it back again safely and dealing with all the temperature and thermal issues and everything is just profound. And to be able to display how that's done and inspire kids with the sheer size of it and this piece of history that was very special, I think is a very valuable contribution that the Science Center makes. I was hired into the astronaut corps as a pilot astronaut. So my background is as a military test pilot, and that's always the case when we hire pilot astronauts for the shuttle. We want people with that flight test background. Most of us also had fighter attack background. I was an attack pilot in the Air Force with F-111s prior to becoming a test pilot and going through test pilot school. So with that background, you're hired in to train on the first flight of the shuttle. You'll be in the right seat. It's really a co-pilot position, but we're all a very experienced instructor pilots, test pilots, everything. We don't want to be called co-pilots necessarily, but it's a co-pilot position. You're second in command. You support the commander. One big difference in the shuttle with most crew airplanes, all the critical systems are in the middle and both can reach them and they're kind of trained. In the shuttle, there's just so many different things that you have to have the division of responsibility. For example, all the electrics and hydraulics, it's all over on the right. So the pilot has to be totally up on that. All the environmental control stuff's on the left. The commander's also responsible for the computers up here. So there's a lot of division of responsibility in a way that's different from most multi-place airplanes. So you train on all those systems in the right, and as a rookie pilot, you know, you haven't been there before, so you know, a lot of things you don't know about till you get there as far as working on orbit. But then you become a commander after one or two flights. You transition to the left. You've learned an awful lot about these systems just from the sitting through the training flow in the simulator and on orbit in the right seat. So I actually found the systems part of it pretty easy, becoming a commander. The systems are less complex than everything you have to do as a pilot. Plus, I was experienced by that point. But the real challenge then becomes the human element, building the cohesive team, being aware of everything that's going on in the preparation. You're the one on orbit where the buck stops there, you know, and you have ultimate responsibility for the safety of the vehicle and the crew. And that was what, at the end of the day, was the best part of that job for me. I mean, the technical stuff now, I mean, I look at this and I've forgotten most of it. You know, I could sort of, maybe I could work my way through a few of the procedures or something now, but I don't really care about forgetting that stuff now at this point in my life. But the memories of the people interactions and what we did as a team in NeuroLab, those are the most precious things to me now. And those were the elements that made it different being a commander from being the pilot. To dream big, if you're a kid, just figure out something that really jazzes you, that you love. You know, there's the old saying that if you have a job you love, it's like never going to work. And figure that out, and then work hard for it. And if it happens to be in the sciences, that's great, because we need scientists and engineers to continue to move us forward. But if it happens to be in something else, follow your passion. My oldest daughter grew up from the time she was two, just spinning around the house, loving dance, went into classical dance, and then got a full ride to college on a ballet scholarship, and then danced professionally for 7 years after college. So she never wanted to be an astronaut. In fact, her major in college was political science and the humanities and that kind of stuff. But she followed her dream, and that's what I would tell kids. And if that dream happens to be science and engineering, maybe going to space, great. But if it happens to be something else, just pursue it with passion.